Jeremy, why do you think this staff and the way it's set up maybe better positions you for success this season?
Well, you know, having six guys offensively I think is important. When you have an offensive coordinator like Jim who really could coach any position, especially in individual drills, you know, if the running backs need to work on something or wide receivers, tight ends, quarterback, whatever position it is, he can kind of bounce around and look at it, kind of like I can do on defense. You know, I'm really the fifth assistant on the defensive side of the ball. We have somebody in charge of every position, but I can kind of bounce around, and if there's something that needs to be tweaked or fixed, I can kind of oversee it.
Just obviously you didn't know all the people you were going to lose on staff, but when you were trying to build the staff again, what were the big ingredients you were looking for where you figured you had to get better in order to compete more?
Well, I think it starts with player development. I think you got to be good teachers. I think our guys are really good teachers. I think we've done a good job getting guys that are familiar with the positions that they coach. If you look at their background, and I think, 16 national championships that our staff's been a part of, that's a lot. I don't know how many more staffs out there would have more than that. So I think being good teachers, good coaches, and being good recruiters, and I think we've hit it with all the guys.
Jeremy, with this new staff, you approach spring ball a little differently as opposed to last year when you were just getting started. Talk about that and maybe the goals initially as you get cranked up here.
Well, I think as a staff, we've hit the ground running. You know, there's really a lot of carryover, especially on the offensive side of the ball. I know we've added Jim, but, you know, some of the things that he's done, things that we had did here last year, and he has a very unique way in a teaching progression. I think he's very efficient with his time, his words. I think it's simple, and I think our coaches and players are excited in the direction we're going. Defensively, you know, when you talk about Derek Ansley, he's a guy that was a graduate assistant for me for 2 years and then was the defensive backs coach. And so, you know, we're very familiar with each other. You know, I think it's good to work from the back to the front. So I think he brings a lot of experience, coached a lot of really good players. And probably when I start a sentence, he can finish it.
Jeremy, a couple things. Will you continue to call plays on defense and kind of more on Ansley? Did you, you know, when you first worked with him at Alabama, I guess when he was a graduate assistant, did you know kind of his future trajectory could be what it is working in the NFL, working in the SEC, and now being a defensive coordinator?
Right. I think Derek's been in very high demand for the last several years. Obviously, he was the highest paid DB coach in the NFL after only being there for 1 year. But you know, he's a guy that is ready for this. He's been ready for quite some time. I think with the fact that with Derek and Kevin and Chris and Tracy in one room, I can already see the cohesiveness together. They communicate well together. They've all worked together, you know. So, you know, I guess Tracy's probably the only one that hadn't worked with Derek, but he actually was a coach at Troy State when Derek played. So everybody knows each other. You know, we've had a really productive last week, kind of getting ready for spring ball. So I think we're headed in the right direction there. And you know, Derek will call the defense this fall.
Coach, you spend a lot of your time back there with the secondary. Last year you had Charles Kelly and Terry back there, so kind of three voices. Does it make a difference going from kind of three voices to two? And then the John Lilly role, will you be in a rush to, you know, kind of fill that role, or will you kind of take your time and find the right guy to kind of fill his spot?
Well, I think, you know, Derek's the defensive back coach. But one thing that you need is you do need another guy back there that can help, because when you do individual drills, then the drills for the safeties and the corners are really different. So somebody's got to run the safety drills, somebody's got to run the corner drills. I mean, last year, you know, most of the time I ran the corner drills anyhow. So we'll continue on that path. And, you know, we have a really good young graduate assistant in Nate Andrews, who played for me at Florida State, and is a guy that I think has got a very bright future also. So that gives us three guys back there.
Jeremy, when you look at how lenient the NCAA has been with immediate eligibility for non-grad transfers, are you optimistic that Solomon and Gibbs will get immediate eligibility?
You know, I'm really not that familiar with what's going on with it, Jimmy. We'll see, and that'll be up to the people that review those situations. Well, I think his heart's in college football. He's a tremendous recruiter. He has passion for young people. He's a very good teacher. And he had lots of opportunities, to leave the Raiders this offseason, and he chose to stay. But I think the opportunity to be the defensive coordinator here, to work with the men on our staff, was something that he couldn't turn down. Well, I just think he's ready. He's somebody that's been in the back end with me. We obviously wasn't together last year, but the two previous years, has a really good idea of why we want to call something and when we want to call it.
Other questions for Coach? Jesse?
Just how did David Johnson kind of handle his reshuffle? I know he's obviously coached running backs at a previous stop, but the wide receiver unit, took some steps forward a year ago compared to where they had been the previous couple seasons here. How did he kind of, handle that and kind of brought that to him?
Well, I think anytime you get men that are used to leading organizations, David was a head coach in high school, and when you do that, you have to coach a number of positions. Everybody wants what's best for the team, and everybody figures out what their role is and does the best at their role. And I think David's a guy that's he's willing to do whatever he needs to help Tennessee football get back to where it's supposed to be. Well, versatility. I think Jim's done it a bunch of different ways. You just track his career. He's thrown the ball 50 times in a game. He's a guy that's had lots of balance. And he's had he's done it when he's been dominant running the football. So he figures out the strengths of his players and tries to, create scheme that fits them. And I think he's really tough to defend. He's very multiple. He gets it. Just me being around him, a lot of pluses that I didn't know. I think he's a great evaluator. He's got command in a room. He sees the big picture. So I'm excited to see what we do this spring and moving forward through the summer and fall. Well, I don't think what point we start pursuing him really matters. I think it's all about where you end up. It's kind of like recruiting. We start recruiting a bunch of them right now, but really the only ones that matter is the ones you get. So I think that's really what's important, is we got him, and that's the most important thing.
Wes? Jeremy, it's kind of a vague question. I get it. But when you look at sort of how much you know about the program now and what you need and what you don't have as maybe compared to like a year ago, how much more do you know in terms of just sort of having a firm grasp on sort of what you have here and what you need?
Well, it's really a good question. And I think if you look at us this time last year, there was not a lot of familiarity with the roster. There were very few guys that I had a relationship with. There were very few guys that we had even recruited at other stops that I had been at. So we really didn't know much about what we were getting in each individual player. So, when you're doing kind of your OTAs and getting ready for spring ball and starting spring practice, you kind of, to the best of your knowledge, put guys at spots that you think that they can be successful. But it's very interesting when you go back and watch the first day of spring practice last year, where guys were at and where they ended up by the end of the season. As far as positions, lots of them changed positions. And so one thing that I think is going to be really good and going to give us a jump start in the second year is we know the players. We know the guys that we recruited. We know how the puzzle needs to fit together. I think our players in return know the expectations of off-season conditioning, how we're going to go about our business in practicing, having another year under their belt, in systems with concepts that they understand. So, you know, to me that's exciting because I think the first day of spring ball we'll have a chance for guys to be playing the positions that they'll be playing in the fall. So they'll get 15 practices in the spring at positions that they'll play in the fall. So that didn't necessarily happen last year. So that's one way that I think from a player development standpoint, guys are going to have an opportunity to improve and improve in a hurry.
Coaches, you've had to make these changes and hire new guys. How much has it meant that Coach Former's kind of opened up the checkbook and let you go out and spend adequate money to kind of, you know, bring Tennessee up to where most people are as far as salary and that kind of thing?
Well, I'm not really concerned where everybody else is at. I'm just concerned about where we're at. And I think, you know, we're committed to having the best staff we can possibly have to help get us to where we want to be.